Him, Steve, yes, all on me. All right, well, welcome everyone to the Washington County Chamber of Commerce Black Advisory Business Council. And today we have a special presentation. But before we do that, how about we just go around the room and do some introductions. Just real simple, your name, your business name, and what you do. For example, my name is Titonian Wallace. I'm one of the founding members of the Black Advisory Business Council. I'm on the Washington County Chamber of Commerce Board of Directors as well. I'm the owner of Nasace Media, which is a digital marketing agency here in Hillsboro, Oregon. And I'll just go around as my screen and call your name if you can unmute yourself at the time and just give a brief introduction, your name, your company, and what you do. And we'll start with our chamber people. Nancy.
Good evening. Buenos tardes. My name is Nancy. I am the Director of Inclusion and Multicultural Business Development and Engagement for the Washington County Chamber of Commerce. Thank you for being here.
Evan.
My name is Evan Goss-Lamel. I am the Black Business Engagement Coordinator here with the Washington County Chamber of Commerce. And again, thank you guys for all coming.
Brad.
Brad Smith with Windsor Properties. We manage and own workforce housing in mostly Washington County, but the greater Portland metropolitan area. And I'm also on the Chamber Board.
Deborah.
Hi, I'm Deborah Wild, owner and founder of Deborah Wild Design, Interior Design and Color Consulting for the Built Environment in the Pearl in Portland. Thanks for having me.
Christy.
Christy Dodge with Dodge Media Productions.
Did you hear that?
Yes, we heard you, Deborah.
I'm a video producer and podcast producer.
Valya. Thanks for being here, Valya.
Good afternoon. Thank you for inviting me, Titonia. Valya Skandari from Edge Web Design Group. We design engaging and high-performance websites that speak directly to our clients' target market and ensures that they stand out from the competition.
Tony.
Hey, everyone. Tony Varela, I'm with Metafab. We are precision sheet metal fabricators in Hillsboro. I'm also on the Washington County Chamber Board. Thank you.
Danny. You're on mute.
Did you say Ann or, oh, Danny, sorry.
Danny, yeah.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Excellent, cool. So my name is Danny Morado. I'm part of the City of Hillsboro. I'm the new Supplier Diversity Program Administrator, and Steve Lee sent me an invite. So I'm happy to be here, and it's nice to meet you all.
Thanks for being here. Steve.
Good afternoon. Steve Crouchide from Hillsboro Medical Center, on the Chamber Board, and in responsible for community health outreach and so on, and have a son and daughter-in-law who are very interested in this topic. So listening in and very, very curious. Thanks.
Great. Kimberly. Oh, my screen moved too.
Hello, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Good. My name is Kimberly Moreland, and I'm the owner of Moreland Resource Consulting. I'm a member of the Chamber of Commerce, and I help small businesses and nonprofits with fund development, historic research, and other little things to help their development and grow.
Ivan.
Hey, good late afternoon. Ivan Hurtado here with Primerica Financial Services. And gosh, I'm here because I was just really excited to see this vision of having entrepreneurs and specifically those in the minority population be represented. So that's why I'm here supporting my friends.
Thanks for coming, Ivan. It's been a while since I've seen you.
Yeah.
Stephanie.
Hi, everyone. My name is Stephanie Wilson, and I own Altice Cross Virtual Assistant Services. And so I assist clients all over the United States, primarily in the Portland area, with many tasks most of the time it's social media management, but I'm always interested in hearing eco-friendly, creative ways to solve some of the problems in our area and around the country. So I'm really interested in hearing what this presentation has to say.
Raina.
Hello, everyone. I'm Raina Evans. I'm one of the founding members of the council. And I am the owner of Ready to Rent, which is a rental housing education curriculum and program that's used by agencies all across the United States and all across Canada.
And Tiffany. I'll keep moving if she, is it Michelle?
Yes. Hi, Michelle Brass. My company is Brass Design. I'm a graphic designer and I specialize in corporate branding and identity. And I'm interested in this too. I just think it's a great resource for helping some of the issues we have today facing, you know, the real estate market. And it's just a friend kind of introduced me to this. And I hope to become a member of the chamber at some point. I'm kind of this is my first event. So looking forward to it.
Cool. Thanks for being here. Natasha.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Natasha Dorsett. I am the owner of NAPAD General Contractor, LLC.
Scott.
Hi, everyone. I'm Scott with Cascade Engineering. We provide structural design for homeowners and businesses here in Hillsboro and also elsewhere in Oregon and Washington.
Anne.
Good afternoon. My name is Anne Keddington. I'm also a Washington County Chamber member as I work as a business development and marketing director for Geneva Financial Home Loans, Beaverton Branch. So this topic obviously comes up in conversation quite a bit when we're talking about housing options. So I wanted to kind of be the face of our Batesukas Group team today and be able to share some information back with our team. Thanks for having us.
And Ty.
Hi, everyone. My name is Ty Schwafferman. I'm a program coordinator with Washington County Supportive Housing Services and the Office of Equity, Inclusion, and Community Engagement. And just really just excited about this topic. All things housing is an interest of mine, and also just continue to stay engaged in the chamber.
Is it Cicely or Cecilia?
Cecilia. Hi, everyone. Cecilia Giron with LULAC. It stands for the League of United Latin American Citizens, and it's a nonprofit 501c4 organization across the country. And I am the director of Oregon LULAC here in the state of Oregon. And this topic is very critical and important to me and my community, specifically because of what devastation that we have seen with the wildfires. And our work has been supporting Latino community, indigenous communities that were affected dramatically in the Alameda fire. So I'm also interested on looking for different solutions on how do we solve the biggest problems that we have specifically in housing. Thank you.
Thank you. Natalie.
Owner and baker of Lucille and Annie's Pound Cakes. And I've been a member of the Hillsboro Chamber of Commerce coming up on a year this November.
Let's see if I missed anyone. Screen moved a couple of times. Teresa. Oh, and I think I see one more.
Hi, I am Teresa Greeno with Transaction Realty Northwest. I am a local realtor, so housing is very important to me, especially working with a lot of first-time homeowners and the shortages we have. So I'm looking forward to this.
And Jelana. Can't hear you if you're speaking and you're not muted. Nope, can't hear you. Nope. I see you moving, but that's it. All right. Is there anyone else that I missed? If so, just unmute and introduce yourself. I don't think so. No? Okay, and I'll do a brief introduction for our guest speaker today, and then let him tell you a little bit about himself, and then we'll move into the full presentation. But first, I'd like to thank you all once again for being here for the Washington County Chamber of Commerce Black Advisory Business Council special presentation, Living in Metal, It's a Green Thing. Our guest speaker today is MinNefer, and a little bit about MinNefer before we pass it over to him. MinNefer, also known as MJ, is the owner and president of Azura Green Concepts, also known as AGZ. It specializes in shipping container for residential and commercial real estate use, which is why a lot of you are here today, and it's good to see that we have some people in the real estate field here as well. MJ earned his undergraduate degree from Augsburg University in Minneapolis, Minnesota, and his MBA from Indiana Institute in Indianapolis. MJ has worked in the field of construction and real estate development to assist several companies, including Prosper Portland, AT&T, and McDonald's Corporation. So without further ado, I'd like to go ahead and pass it over to our speaker, MinNefer.
All right, cool. I guess I can share. Am I sharing my screen? Yes. Anybody see the screen?
Yes.
Hey.
That's you. Hello, everyone. How's everybody doing? Welcome, welcome, welcome. I am MinNefer Mernahkem, also known as MJ, President and CEO of Azura Green Concept. Some people are probably asking, where did our logo come from? Our logo came from, I was in construction for quite a bit of time, built a construction company, sold a construction company, and like a dummy, turned around and bought the construction company right in 2008 when the recession hit. And it crashed and burned. And so as I was beginning to rebuild, I said, what do I want to be known for? And I said, you know what? The Phoenix. You crash, you burn, you start over. And so we started off as a building custom homes, which was, you can get nickel and dime building a custom home. So I was like, yeah, this is not cool. Did a trip down to New Orleans during Hurricane Katrina. Saw that shipping containers were being used for storage as well as using temporarily for housing, and kind of came up with the concept. Like most ideas, I was at a bar with a couple of friends with a napkin, and we were drawing, and we were like, hey, I think we need to create something out of the shipping containers. And so my lovely wife designed these. She's not here. She is on the school board. They have a meeting tonight. So she designed these little blocks, and we kind of use these as, before we build anything, we kind of use these as our template to start building. Before we start building, before we put anything in plan, we start building and playing around with the blocks and wanting to come up with a design. And to Tony, a question for you. This is not moving. All right. So when I was coming up with a title for this, I was trying to think of what would be a cool title to use. And so I let my 15-year-old come up with the title, and he said, Living in Metal, It's a Green Thing. I said, okay, does that sound corny? He said, no, because I created it. But if you created it, it would be corny. So shout out to my son who decided to come up with the title versus dad, that he didn't want me to be corny. So thank you, son. All right, why shipping containers? I look at shipping containers, one, they're designed. I'm going to use this as an example. You can take a shipping container, put it on the back of an 18-wheeler, and you can ship it just about anywhere across the country that you want to ship it. We do a lot of our manufacturing here with one of my partners, who happens to be one of the most fabulous metal workers that I have encountered, Metal Art by Stu. Brilliant, brilliant, brilliant man. So why shipping containers? The design, if you've ever seen them on a ship, people always asking, how come they never fall over? There's a metal clamp, like a screw and bolt that screws them in, and you can stack them up to six feet, six high or eight high. Let me know if I'm going too fast, if I'm not making any sense. All right. So most shipping containers are made out of corrugated steel. 90% of them are made in Japan, Europe, Korea, Hong Kong, and Taiwan. How many shipping containers are there? Right now, estimate there's 17 million shipping containers. There are 11 million shipping containers that are not being used right now. Some people say, well, why not? Well, we don't really manufacture a lot. So normally the manufacturing comes from these countries. They're bringing products in, but no products are going back. So it's cheaper to actually just make them versus trying to recall them back. Most containers, as I said, they sit on, you can go anywhere where there is a dock in the US and you'll find shipping containers. Anywhere where there's a shipping dock, you'll find shipping containers. There are shipping containers here. There are shipping containers in Washington. I think one of the biggest one in California is in Long Beach. So they're all over the country, anywhere that you pretty much have shipping docks. All right, how are they built? This is the thing, if you look to the right, shout out to our RSCP. They do a lot of design work and they were so kind and generous to send us these photos of how a shipping container is made. So if you look on the left-hand side, and if you can see my mouse here, this is basically the foundation of a shipping container, this metal. And then you have your floors and you have your corrugated steel, and then you have your doors, so here. So what's the cool thing about shipping containers is that they're designed to survive a rough sea. You know, if you ever seen a shipping container, normally it takes them, if they fall off a ship, it takes them about a week and a half to sink. That's how waterproof and tight sealed they are. But what's cool about them is that you can take them, you can cut them, you know, but a lot of people will wind up trying to over duplicate the cutting, like cutting here or cutting here, which is not recommended. So shipping containers come in a variety of sizes. Me and my wife, we always have this argument because my wife at one time was the CEO until she decided to go do bigger and greater things and gave me back my job. To me, finding 40 footers are the easiest ones to find. And finding 40 footers, they're either 8x6 in height, so 8 foot, 6 feet, or 9 feet. 9 feet to me is the better, because that gives you, anytime that you take a ceiling down, you're going down from 7 feet. If you're going from 9 feet, once you put a ceiling in, that takes it to 8 feet. She likes the 53 because they're big, but the problem with 53 footers, they're hard to find. 20 feeters, they're cool, but to me, I get claustrophobic, so it's too small for me. So I don't particularly care for them because they're too small, but would it make a great, in the backyard, 80 RDRs, I may miss a word, correct me somebody, you can ADU. Put them in the back. Thank you. As my wife says, she shed, they would make a great she shed. So if you have the space, you know, a 20 footer is recommended, but we normally work with 40 footers. Occasionally we get our hands on a 53 footer. We try to use as much as we possibly can. Let me know if I'm going too fast. What do you need? In my experience, you know, we've been doing this. This is coming up on our 9th year. When we first started, there was no videos. There was no books. there was nothing really available to find. I kind of found a couple people online here and there, and we kind of talked about things. So in my experience of when we put this together, like I said, there was nothing out there. And so I kind of did what I did, what I call is a data dump. And so in the data dump, you know, when Tetonian asked me to do this, I was like, man, I don't really have a presentation for this because I never really thought about a presentation. But then we wound up doing presentations to banks that went womp womp, didn't go so well. So from that, we kind of, you know, got punched in the face of trying to learn all the things that we need. And here, you know, finally we realized these are what we need. You need capital, you need land, you need the shipping containers, engineers, you need drawings, permits. Let me say permits again, permits. Let me say permits again, permits. Let me say permits again, permits. That's the part we didn't figure out. We learned it the hard way. We built one and then we went to the permit department. They said, well, do you have this built? You're like, yeah, we had this, but we kind of told on ourselves, you shouldn't do that. You shouldn't build something first and then go to the permitting office and try to get a permit for it. Normally it doesn't work that well. You need an excavator, welder, cranes, crews. You need framers. Two type of framers. You need an inside frame and outdoor framer, you know, to be able to frame it. Some guys only do interior framing. Some guys only do exterior framers. So that's why you see two types of framers. Welders. The welder is your best friend. Welder is your right-hand man, right-hand woman. You can't do this project without a welder. Welders are the heart, mind, and guts and soul of anything you do on a project. You need framers. I said framers twice again, because you got framers on the outside, framers on the inside. Insulation. One of the biggest things that we learned about insulation, that insulation is extremely important. And I'll go in more in detail why insulation is so important. Drywallers, the HVAC, you know, heating, your cooling and heating, finished carpenters, power and water, electricity. I'll talk touch a little bit later on about the importance of power, electricity, and a cost that you don't expect, but a cost that you'll wind up getting if you're in an area that doesn't have electricity and water. Am I going too fast? Is it making sense? All right. So my wife asked me to come up with the good, the bad, and the ugly. And so the good, the bad, and the ugly is things that we've experienced personally as we, you know, went out and start building. Now, if you look at YouTube, there's information, overflood of information on YouTube about how to do this. But when we started, there was no information. And so we kind of learned as we went. The good, the toughness, they're durable. I call it, they're very creative and free. You can be very creative. They're going to be different than anything that you're going to see in a traditional neighborhood. Multiple sizes to choose from. It's a great investment opportunity. To me, if you look at how the market is going right now, you can't find a house for under $480,000, you know, to get in. So to me, I like it just because it's mobile. You know, you can put them on the back of a truck and ship them off. You can stack them up. You can actually do the work in a pre-location. You can then take them, pack them, put them on a truck, send them out. I like it because they have an open floor plan. I look at the house that I live in right now, it is a shipping container. People say it's not a shipping container, but when you look at it, you start looking at houses a little bit different. So here's the things that I ran into when I first tried to get an investment. And this is what I heard from bankers. This is what I heard from investors. Hey, it's a hot box. You know, it's like, yeah, it could be a hot box if not insulated properly. It's a cold box. Yeah, it could be extremely cold in the winter months. It reminds me of something that should be on the trailer park. This is the one I always got, the number one always concerned about, that I don't want to look like I live in a trailer park. Nothing wrong with trailer parks, but that's what a lot of people have the vision. It looks like something I would store junk in. They're rumored to rust easily, which is not true. They're rumored not to be safe, which is not true. They can cost as much as a traditional building. Yes and no, depending on what you're building and what you're spending. They're rumored to be risky to build. I think anything that you do can be risky to build. You know, now here's the ugly part. Permits, codes, and unexpected expenditures. So what I mean by permits, like we did a couple of these projects before going to the planning department to get permits. We didn't realize we needed a permit and that we had to, in order to get these built, we had to fall under the housing guidelines of cities. So that was probably, we got fined probably four times. And so that was a hard kick in the teeth that you have to learn. The other thing, NIMBY, not in my backyard. You have some people like, ain't no way this is going up in my neighborhood. I'm not feeling this. This looks like some trailer park trash and I'm not having it. And so, we had to wind up learning to go to the planning department in order to appeal a lot of the decisions that people were like, nah, don't want it. Biggest thing you get, harmful chemicals. You know, because these things are designed to keep fish out and the design, you have to make sure that you epoxy the floors. They come with nice hardwood floors. Either you got to sand them or seal them. You can't just use them because you never know what has been imported or exported in these shipping containers. Some shipping containers have chemicals that have been shipped that are just not very good for the environment, not very good for people. The other thing that we ran into, and I'm pretty sure everyone can do this, call you're in the country, is skyrocketing, especially here. This one, we started this one. This was our first project. We got an old shipping container. We were so excited. And that was the worst experience we ever had. And we learned from that, do not buy old rusted shipping containers. It's not a good look for you. And then the other problem, COVID. COVID has hit. And so COVID now has risen the price of steel. And because these are made out of corrugated metal and steel, the price has kind of gone up just a tad bit. So those are the things that we learned from the good, the bad, and the ugly. But I always like to take Bruce Lee. You have to dig down into the negativity and pull out the positive. And so looking down in the ugly, we're able to pull out, the good. So once again, let's talk about real talk about toxins. Because they're coated with, some of the floors have asbestos, but if you, like I said before, if you sand them, you seal them, you don't have that problem. One of the biggest things is, I recommend it, in order to stop the toxins is where your foam insulation comes in place. We've tried just about every insulation that you can possibly find. There are new technologies coming online, but we found that foam insulation is probably the best to go. And it's not a DIY project. I learned that the hard way the first time that we tried to do one. I highly recommend hiring professionals. It is not something that you want to take on. It's very messy. It's kind of cool to use, but hire a professional. And that's the way that we learn how to get rid of the hot and cold mentality, how to keep a place cool, how to keep a place warm is the insulation. Insulation is your best friend. It's very expensive, but it's well worth it. All right. So in researching, as we first started, we kind of went around the country and we're looking, who can we talk to? Who do we know? It's kind of like, who knows who? And from here, these are all the places that we found that shipping containers are accepted. The newest one is Ohio and Minnesota. And so that's kind of cool that a lot of planning departments, zoning departments and planning departments are beginning to change. They're beginning to open up a little bit more and saying that, hey, maybe this may be a viable, idea. One of the greatest ones that I've seen, and it's on YouTube right now, there's a gentleman who just built there's transitional shelter, and they built them, 6 to 8 high, and they built a whole community that's helping LA deal with a lot of its homeless population. We're working on 2 projects right now in North Carolina of a person who lost their business in one of the hurricanes. And so she is a beautician by trade, and we're just finishing up her project, and we'll be taking it, putting it on the back of a truck and shipping it down to North Carolina. And she has a group of people that are gonna take it, and they're gonna do all the hookups because she's got all the permits. So that was kind of like a easy project. And then another one we just recently did in North Carolina, we just did a garage. A gentleman wanted a garage for his truck and his car, and we just finished that one. So these are all the places thus far that are allowing shipping containers to be a part of.
A little bit, but also see if there's,
Is living in, another question I always get, is living in a shipping container safe? Absolutely. I think love, they're earthquake proof, they're hurricane proof, they're not 100% proof, but I give them probably a 95%. And you can have them, either they can look like shipping containers, and let you look in this picture, in a residential neighborhood, this is a project that we consulted on, and it doesn't look like a shipping container. So you can have them either to look like shipping containers or not look like shipping containers. But are they safe? Absolutely, they're safe. All right, here are the mistakes that we made in starting off. I hope you know everyone can learn from our mistakes and go out and do bigger and better than what we've done. You know, we've learned, you know, using the 9-foot is better than the 8-foot. You know, buying those shipping containers, I don't recommend it. Using the wrong type of insulation. Foam right now, hopefully foam is kind of, it's not new, but kind of new, especially in shipping containers. The price is beginning to come down, but COVID has made the price go back up. So that's something that we're learning. You know, you only have so many people that are certified, because you have to be certified in order to use foam. So we're finding, can we find a partner to help us with, you know, bringing a lot of the cost down. Over modification, like I said before, you know, when you cut on the steel post that I showed in a picture earlier, you can weaken the foundation. Oftentimes, if you cut out a piece, you just have to go back in and put steel reinforcement or steel beam where you're making cuts at. Using inexperienced contractors. We were the inexperienced contractors because no one had done this before. So we decided to take one, had a friend that had a farm, and we just used the farm to play around and kind of like learn, like, oops, that didn't work. Oops, that's not a good idea. Oops, no, write that down, not do that again. So we kind of, you know, kind of learn from, I call it reverse engineering. Another thing that we learned, not having an engineer. You got to have an engineer because that's the only way you're going to be able to get your permits. No engineer, no permits. Engineer is the next heart and soul to what it is that you're doing. Got to have an engineer to be able to explain how structurally sound these shipping containers are. And if he or she can't explain it to the person that's giving you the permit, you're on a lose-lose situation. So it's very important to make sure that you have an engineer. Using the right foundation. I can't stress this enough. Got to make sure that you have the right foundation because if it's just sitting on top of the foundation, and that's one thing that we found out from a funding standpoint, if it's not grounded to the ground, then it's considered to be a mobile home. And so in most mobile homes, they don't give loans for mobile homes. And so you have to let people know this is not a mobile home. Yes, we did transport it here, but it's going to be fine. It's going to be permanently connected to the foundation. Understanding climate zones, depending where you're at, you can create that hot box or you can create the cold effect. If it's not properly insulated, if it's not properly shielded from rust, because you can be in a sea salt climate that can easily rust it out. So you have to make sure you understand what climates that you're in. So, you know, we learned that the hard way that we built something with the wrong insulation in a very muggy humidity. And that was not good because it created a sweat box. The biggest thing that I've learned, talking and telling people who don't understand your vision. You know, when I was telling people this, people were like, okay, this dude's a madman. What the heck is he doing? I have never heard of that. Why would you put somebody in a shipping container? That's like putting somebody in a coffin. I mean, you hear all kind of negativity. And so you have to learn, keep your ideas sometime to yourself. Until you get the right kind of people that have, you got to get, I call it crazy people like yourself. You got to get crazy people who have these crazy ideas that can create something that's so far out there that, yeah, I think we can do it. You think we can do it? Yeah, I think we can do it. And oftentimes when that happens, it's normally over a couple of beers. Then you find out how really crazy you are. And then once you sober up, you're like, oh, we was going, well, I guess we're here now. You know, so you learn to, you know, to have fun with it. Container costs. A used container can run you around $2,000. A new container can run you anywhere from $3,000 to $6,000. And the project that we're working on right now, there's 9 containers. These are brand new. Nothing's ever been put in them. There's like 36, but we're trying to get them to come down on the price a little bit more. If anyone's interested, we can always take a trip to pdxcontainer.com, which is here in Oregon, in Portland. It's a cool place. And if you haven't had a chance to just step inside a shipping container, you gotta walk into a shipping container because you're like, nah, there's no way we could do anything like that. And that's where the creativity comes from. And that's where the craziness comes in, that you're gonna take this box and you're gonna create it for a house for someone to live in. Am I going too fast? Is everybody okay? So over the years, what we've learned, this gives you a quick rundown of the cost. I'm not going to go through all the numbers, but as you can see, these are the numbers. So this is for a project that we're working on right now. This is for 8 containers, 40 footers, 9 feet tall. It'll wind up being 2,720 square feet. With all these costs, we came roughly in about 220,000. So it just depends. That permitting, it could go up, it can go down. That architect fee, it'll actually go down because my brother works with me, who's an architect. So, you know, I normally just, you know, twist his arm and put my foot on his back and be like, hey, bring the price down. But it's my little brother, so I have that ability to do that. Everyone may not have that ability. I would not recommend going out twisting arms of architects and putting your foot in the back. But because this is my brother, I can do that. But this gives you kind of an idea of what some of the costs are. Some of the costs can go up. Some of the costs can go down. It just depends where you're at, where you're buying your shipping containers, and how big you build. How much container you use, the more the price is going to up. The less you do, the price is going to go down. So this kind of can fluctuate. It can either go up or it can either go down. You'll see here where it says tech package. I'm a geek. So I love technology. So I believe in having technology in anything and everything that we build because it's just the geek in me. It's just what geeks do. You know, you got to have toys and technology. You know, all in favor of being a geek, raise your hands. All right, here's just some of the examples of what you can do with shipping containers. I'm not the first. I'm sure I'm not going to be the last. What we've looked at for a smaller basic container, they run anywhere from $40,000 to $55,000, not including the land and the permit, because once again, that's where you, when you say the difference between a regular house and a shipping container, those don't really change that much. It just depends on what city you're in. And if a city allows it, some cities don't allow it. And so you'll probably have to fight in order to get it to have something to be able to change their procedures and policies to be able to add it. A larger home can work anywhere from $200,000 to $550,000. If you look at the one down here at the bottom, this one was built, this is a shipping container, but the pool is built out of a shipping container. That's built out of a 53 footer. So there's where your prices can kind of go up and your prices can kind of go down. You know, if you look here, this is a simple one. It goes from the simple, you know, in the middle, you know, you're starting to get creep up and you're really creeping up. This is an example of a project that we worked on. This is the, as you see, we kept the original floors, but we use epoxy to seal the floors in. This is the garage that I was telling you, a project that we're working on that we finished for a customer. This is going to be a beauty shop for the lady in North Carolina that we're talking about that we just finished up. She just only wanted a 40 footer, and so we did a 20 footer. This is just her bathroom. This is some of the amenities. She's gonna have someone else finish off. And all we're gonna do is take this. See these hose right here? We're going to take that, put that on the back of a rig and send it off to North Carolina. We're going to package it up, crate it up. And she has a crane crew and she has a crew that'll finishing the plumbing and the electrical. And she'll supply all the chairs and everything else that she needs. Another good thing about this is that it's affordable housing as well as student housing. We were working on a project in Texas, but then COVID hit, actually the hurricane hit and then COVID hit. And so we're going to circle back around, hopefully that we can get back to this. But this is something that was built in the Netherlands, and this is something that was built in LA. So as I'm coming to a conclusion, these are the questions that, you know, people have asked is, you know, what do you need to get into the business? There's a variety of ways you can get into business. You can get in it from a finance standpoint, a real estate standpoint, a welder, a general contractor, electrician, plumber, welder, you name it, you can pretty much on a scale. You know, you can be on one that does it, one that just oversees it, project management. You know, are there areas of opportunities? Absolutely. One of the three markets that I think that are the three biggest markets, if you look around the United States right now, the homeless, that's one, 55 and older, first-time homeowners, and single parents. So four, to me, those are like a, those are the four areas where I see the biggest need. Because if you're a young person graduating right now from college, if you're here in Oregon, you can't afford a house at $450,000 unless you're making that kind of money. So how do we, if you look at when the war happened, we had, I call them, they were military houses. They were small, they were kind of like the same, but it gave people an introduction to be able to get in, to be able to purchase a home and be a homeowner. And if you look at, you have a lot of people who they may only qualify for 375. And we all know that 375 is not a lot trying to get into the housing market. You know, what are some of the obstacles in getting in into this business? For us, you know, being an African-American company, it's been access to capital. That has been our biggest challenge, is access to capital and being able to compete. You know, we feel as though that we can do just about anything everybody can do, and we're a little bit more creative. But, you know, being African-American has definitely been an obstacle being able to find the capital in order to grow as a business. Another obstacle is getting people to be open, you know, about the idea of this being something new and different. You know, I think that's one of the obstacles. Dealing with permitting and zoning. You know, most cities, they have nothing on the books. There's a gentleman in Utah who has been extremely helpful, who did a project before we did. And I just reached out to him on YouTube and told him what I was trying to do. And, you know, it's kind of like a community. Once you connect with one, you know, you just connect. You know, he was telling us what he was trying to do. He was trying to go back. I'm gonna date myself. Going back to the Sears catalog, when you could order a house from the Sears catalog. And for those who don't know who Sears is, Sears used to have where you can order a house out of a catalog, and they would send you the house in a box. And so that's something that he's working on, and that's something that I want to try to work on, especially as we have an aging population. You know, a lot of people don't want to stay in, you know, a three-story house or two-story house. They want a one-story house, but they still want it to be hip and cool. And so that's why we get the Jetsons meets James Bond for a kick-ass technology house, because we wanted to be cool. We wanted to be, I like the retro 60 look. So how do we create something that looks like it's from the retro, but it's here today, and it's cool, it's hip, and you still don't feel, as my son says, Dad, you are outdated, you're boring. I keep telling him I'm not boring, I'm outdated, but he keeps saying that I'm boring, I'm outdated. But when I show him these designs, it's like, oh, that's kind of cool. So when you get your 15-year-old telling you it's kind of cool, you got just a tad bit of coolness. Not much, just a tad bit. And that is the end of my presentation. So I'm open for questions and answers.
Cool. Thank you, MinNefer.
Thank you. I hope I didn't bore you guys enough.
Oh, no, I think that was a really, really great and informative presentation, especially for those in the industry or interested in the industry. We have quite a few questions that came through the chat. I'll start with, I think, Valya, you just raised your hand. So if you have a live question that you'd like to ask, let's start there. If you can, just use the reaction button and raise your hand so I can see you on here, and I'll call on you to ask your question. And then I'll do the ones that came in the chat. So Valya, do you want to go ahead and ask your question?
Sure. I was actually clapping for Nefer, and thank you.
Oh, I'm sorry.
But I can ask a question, because I do have a question. So when one of these houses are built, and let's say a few years down the road, you want to modify something, you want to add a section or do any modification, is that possible?
So once again, I'll show my lovely wife's designs. And that's why these are so good. So let's say you start off with one. You only have one. If you cut open, you can add a second one. You want to go up, you can add a second floor. You say, hey, now I want to go up a little bit higher. You can keep adding. That's the cool thing about them, is that they allow you to, I don't know if everybody can see that, they allow you to keep adding. And so yes, to answer your question, you're absolutely right. Yes, you can add, modify, you can change.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Do you mind sharing your screen again with the pictures?
Sure.
Any more live questions, or I can move to the chat questions now?
Those pictures?
I have a question.
I don't know. Whoever went first, go ahead.
This is Kimberly. Hi, MJ.
Hey, Kimberly.
How are you?
I'm splendid. Hey, me and Kimberly used to work together.
Yeah. Thank you for a wonderful presentation. And I'm just curious, besides housing, can you use the containers for like office and retail?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. We, before the pandemic hit, we built a barbershop, a beauty shop, and a coffee shop. But neither one of all three of those closed, unfortunately. And so they're trying to debate, do they send it back to us? Do we buy them back? So we're kind of waiting and seeing what the three want to do. But yes, it has a lot of opportunities for commercial. One of the one things I've been thinking about is that you have a lot of small businesses that are trying to be in the restaurant business. I think this would be ideal as a pop-up shop. I think these would be awesome as pop-up shops for restaurants, especially for, you know, small restaurants that are trying to get their foot. They can't afford a truck, but maybe they can afford one of these as a commercial spot in order to start up as a restaurant. There is a cool restaurant. If you ever want to see one, it's in downtown Portland, across Kitty. And there's a Mexican restaurant that is in a shipping container.
And that's important?
So Kimberly, you know where we used to work at? You know where that coffee shop that's behind Prosper?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. The hotel?
Yeah.
It's Kitty Corner down the street where that parking lot is.
Okay, I'll check that out. Yeah. At the Society Hotel.
Yep, and then there's another one. I don't know how to get there, but there's a Starbucks that is built out of shipping container that's going out close to the airport.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Brad.
Oh, it was a good presentation. We've been looking at this concept for a while because we have multiple properties, especially in Hillsborough, that are big. They're older platted subdivisions with big lots that have room for accessory dwelling type things like this. And the one that caught my attention was you said the smaller one could be built in that 40 to 55 range. I'm assuming that's just the container. Everything else is added on.
Correct.
Like your foundation, your utilities, your permits, and everything like that. Have you seen anyone around the country that are doing these, that are just producing them and dropping them as investment properties, as opposed to building a custom for their house? Because it seems like it could be a very good thing for the housing shortage and also affordable housing. So just wondering if that's happening.
To answer your question, yes and no. I've seen them, but they're on the cheap. And so they look cheap. So it looks like a shipping container house. And then there are those that can customize, but they're more like tiny homes. I don't do tiny homes. I'm claustrophobic, so I don't do tiny homes. But I can send you a list of the companies that I do know that do them versus, you know, us. You know, we're doing them, but we haven't got to the point where we can mass produce. That's something that we've been trying to work on. How can we start to manufacture and just, you know, package it here and send it off and let you do. There's a company in Canada, and they get you because you're like, oh, 55, but they don't tell you about the permitting. They don't tell you about the, you know, the zone. They don't tell you about the other things that take into place that can take that property from 55 to maybe 255.
Yeah, there's a lot of stick built project houses that are like that, that say, oh, we can build you this 2,200 foot house for 125. And that's just the house. I mean, right. And there's everything else probably doubles it or maybe even more than doubles it. So.
Absolutely.
And Natasha.
Hi. I just want to say thank you. Your presentation was very useful. I've been trying to look into that myself, and there's so much information out there. You know, it's kind of like can be overwhelmed at times. But my question to you is, I've looked at some of your project for the interior. When you do the insulation, do you use any type of framing to hang your drywall into? If so, what type of framing? Do you use advanced or traditional framing?
Traditional framing, but the one thing that we're doing that's different, that I call it it's my wife's idea. My wife's idea is to use gypsum board, but it's kind of like wood framing. And so instead of doing your traditional 2x4s, you actually put plywood throughout, and then you put your drywall. And she said the reason why she wants to do that, she's like, if I want to hang a picture, I want to be able to hang a picture and not worried about missing, did I get the right stud? You know, I don't need a stud finder. So by putting the plywood, you can, one, it's another form of insulation. Two, it allows you to hang a picture anywhere and everywhere that you want to hang a picture. So I would say it's traditional. You could use steel framing, but to me, if you're going to use steel framing, the price is going to go up because it's steel. But you can do is traditional 2x4s. And what we've done, instead of doing them flat, we do them horizontal, and that's how we're doing our framing. And so from there, the insulation is, we'll put the insulation in, they'll cut everything off, and then we'll put the plywood in, and then we'll put the drywall up.
Thank you. What about, because I also see you guys have doors and window and some of that. Do you use your, if you guys trying to put a window, do you use the same system that we use in regular construction to seal? Because I'm thinking Oregon, it rains a lot, and it's been, it has been a big issue. Like every time we're trying to cut our walls, you know, the sealing process itself, it's a lot. So what is the process you guys use to seal that cut into that metal?
So when you take a shipping container and you cut a hole in it, you have to put reinforcement in. You know, any engineer worth his salt will tell you that you gotta put, you know, some form of support beam back in. And mm-hmm. Normally when we put that support back in, that's when we put the window in. So the window, we make sure that the window is flat, the window is sealed. And then once we put wherever we cut at, then we go back and we use another form of a foam in order to seal that gap up. So therefore there is no gaps when we make cuts. And so that's how you make sure that you get a window tight seal, is by making sure that when you go back in, you're replacing the framing that you've taken out. So let's say you take Okay, let's say that you take this panel out right here. If you're gonna take out that panel, you gotta put steel reinforcement. It can mm-hmm. be two by two steel beams, or it could be 2x4s. Anything that you take out, you gotta make sure that you're supporting. So if you're putting a door frame in, you gotta make sure that you're putting another form of framing where you're taking it out so you can make sure that it stays strengthened. Oftentimes when we open up and we connect, we normally will put another beam across. We'll weld another beam across so there's no seams so water can get in. Another thing that we do is we always do like an angle roof. Although this is flat, water still can get trapped on it. And so if you do an angle roof, then the water can roll off. And then another thing about the water rolling off, you can then take that water and collect it as reusable water for a garden.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Good question. Volia.
How long does it take on average from beginning to the end to build one of these? I understand it has to do with the size of the property, but on average, how long does it take?
It depends on where you're at, and it depends on your zoning and planning. That's the biggest time is zoning and planning, you know, because being able to get a permit, you can do 9 containers in a day, put them together, and then it's just welding and cutting. You know, then it becomes like traditional housing. The only thing that we do is we always do like a little tent. And so in the tent, we use the tent in the wintertime where there's rain, there's snow, to keep it off of it, and sparks are flying. And so it's easier to do faster. Once you get in, it kind of goes by fast. So I would say anywhere between 3-6 months to a year. And the only reason why that year comes into play is because you're zoning and planning. How fast can you get it through zoning? How fast can you get it through planning in order to get your permits? Because normally that is the hiccup that happens. You know, how long is it going to take you to get it through the zoning and permitting process?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. No, thank you.
You're welcome. As well as, can you make sure that you got your contractors? because construction is booming. And so it's really hard to find good people. And you got to be able to find people who know what they're doing and people who, you know, have the experience and know-how. And normally those that have the know-how are the busiest.
And you don't provide those contacts, engineers, contractors, architects?
No, we have them on staff.
Okay.
Okay, Jelana.
Hi, you might have covered this. I had to hop off to leave swim practice to get home, but does using shipping containers help or the same with infestation, with whether it's molds or insects? You know, we live in a more recent developed area, so we really don't have an issue, but I know if you're taking a shipping container to like raw land or land, how does that impact, especially with mold?
So what's the cool thing about the shipping containers and the inside of them, it's a paint that is mold resistant, water resistant, critter resistance. So that's why you have to make sure that you paint over, because it may have asbestos in it. If you see right here, you see these holes, this is normally where a machine goes in, and that's how they pick up the shipping containers. You take a metal plate and you cover all that around. And so that it allows you to be able to keep out. And if a critter can shoot through this, then I think we need to all get up and run. wherever you cut holes at, you got to make sure that you seal them, you put foam back in them, you put it where nothing can get into it. And so that's something that a lot of things that we had to learn too. We're going to raw land where, you know, we disturbed a farmer's field and we didn't realize how many mice were in the field. And all of a sudden we had mice in the project, and that was not a good look. And then that's when we kind of learned, like, we had to create some kind of barrier to keep them out because they were making their nest under here. So we were able to exterminate and we're able to keep them out. But with this and the drywall and the foam will help, will get to the point where nothing's going to get to less animals going to chew through it. And it has a very, I haven't eaten any of it, but from what I understand from animals, it doesn't have the greatest taste. So it keeps them out.
You mentioned not to buy old ones. How do you find out the history of your shipping container? Do they have like ID numbers, like a VIN number, you know, something equivalent? How do you find out where they, what their story was?
Can you see my cursor? It says PSSU. Can you see that? In the right-hand corner? That right there tells you everything. If you give that information to the shipping container company, they will tell you what has been shipped in it, how many times it's been shipped, what's been shipped in it, and where it's been shipped to. So that's kind of like its own social security number. It's every shipping container has its own DNA. And this is, those numbers are the DNA. And then there's normally a plaque. Every shipping container has a plaque. And on that plaque, the plaque is normally here on the wall, and it'll tell you everything you want to know about the shipping container, where the shipping container came from, where it's going, what was it transferred in, how long it's been sent on the dock. So it'll tell you the life and history of it. And it's actually kind of cool to take. Normally what we do is when we take those plaques off, we take them and we frame them and we give them to the person. And so then the person can say, hey, my shipping container came from Japan. Well, no, mine came, you know, from here. And now you got a story to be able to tell with it, that be able to go with the shipping container.
Hey, do we have any more? Jelana and Natasha, both of your hands are still raised. Do you have another question or no? No, okay.
Yes, I wanted to ask one last question, I promise.
No problem, go ahead.
When you take the container apart and you wanna put the slope and the roof, what type of material do you use for that slope? Do you continue with the metal or have you used different material?
No, we've using wood. We just make, you know, traditional slant roof. I wouldn't recommend cutting the roof unless you're going to stack another one on top of it and have an opening. But then you have to make sure that you're reinforcing what you're opening. You know, I can't stress that enough. you know, whatever you take off, you got to make sure that you are reinforcing whatever you're taking off. And so to do in a traditional, it's just like a traditional wooden roof, which shouldn't cost as much because it's not a real roof. It's, to me, it's like a make-believe roof. And all that make-believe roof is to make sure that water can drain off of it, snow can drain off of it, leaves can drain off of it. So it's not just sitting, you know, there in a puddle. You know, if you're in a salt, if you're in a sea salt climate, that sea salt water can eventually start to erode, you know, your property as it sit there. But if you, you know, you create a roof, now you're creating something that's basically taking water and anything, you know, being able to live on top of the roof.
What slope would you have you worked with before for this type of roof? Would you say three?
We've done what we call the Batman roof. You know, that's where the roof kind of goes in. It looks like it's got
wings. Okay.
We've done, you know, slanted corner. You know, it just depends on what we're building. That determines the roof. We've done a flat roof that has a draining system on it. We've done one where we did it where it was a carport. And so we put, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
No, and so we put it where it had just, when we did the foundation was slightly tilted. So the house was kind of slightly tilted. And so water ran into the pipes in order for a person to do water recollection.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, are there any more live questions before I move to the chat question? You still have a few to go.
I've got a question here.
All right, go ahead.
Hey, great presentation. Thanks a lot, MinNefer.
Thank you.
I'm not sure if you guys are doing this already, so it might not be a question, but basically if you guys are selling, or if you know of companies that are selling the pre-kitted plans, how are they addressing all of the different, I know you mentioned there's permits, but so many different jurisdictions have different requirements. So how have you guys either dealt with, or how have you heard of other companies dealing with?
A lot of companies don't, because they just want to sell you. So what we've done is we do a lot of partnerships. So my cousin, who was an engineer, normally if we're building somewhere, we partner with other engineering firms in different places where we don't have certifications. Because in order to be an engineer, you have to be certified in that particular city or state.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Okay, with that, Tony, do you want me to remove your question you had in chat? I think that answered it for you, right?
Yeah, that's good. Thanks.
Oh, yep. Sorry. Then it says my internet is unstable. So did I answer your question?
Yeah, that's good. Thank you.
Okay, one question from the chat, MinNefer. I think you had a slide that showed this. They may have missed it, but what is the average cost of the different size shipping containers?
Give me a second here. Now, don't hold me to this because this can change depending where you're at and what part of the country. I would tell you the further that you're away from a dock, you know, a port, the further you're away from a port, the more it's going to cost you, because now you're doing transportation to be able to transport from the port. But what I've seen on average, use 2,000, because you don't know what's in them. And this is where the old ones come in, is how to get you newer ones. And when I say newer one, a newer one could be that it was a one ship container. So it may have transferred motorcycles, cars, clothing. Those to me are new shipping containers because they don't have things that could be considered to be contaminated or poison. Sometimes you got poison being transferred. Sometimes you may have a barrel that rusted and it's leaked all in there, but you don't know it. And so your price can go from 3,000 to 6K. Like I said, we're doing one right now. Right now it's about 36K. And the reason why it's 36K, because where we're building, there's not a port. And so we'll eat that cost of being able to transport all of the nine shipping containers to this particular destination because there is no port. And like I said before, if you want to take a tour, I will contact pdxcontainer.com. If you want me to go with you, I can go with you. If you don't want to go with me, you can go by yourself. It's actually pretty cool. And you know, you have brokers. There are a lot of brokers out there that broker deals for shipping containers. But the problem with most of the brokers that are out there, You don't know what you're getting. It is best to always have eyes on sight to see what you're getting, because they can show you something online. You're like, oh, this is great. And you get like, yo, this is not what I ordered. And so it is key to make sure that you can walk it, touch it, smell it, feel it. And so I highly recommend that if it's something you want to take on, you got to have your presence there to see what you're buying. Because if not, they'll sell you anything. And then what are you going to do? You're going like, well, I'm not taking it. Because now you got to do a restocking fee. And who knows how much that restocking fee is going to be for them to take them back from you.
How are insurance companies covering these?
This is about as much as Tesla. So I'm a Tesla fanatic, and I've seen, because they're new and because there's not an abundance of them, to me, it's a lot higher. And the reason why it's a lot higher, because it hasn't been a proven successful method that they adapt. Banks and insurance companies are the last to change and adapt because it's risky. And because it's risky, they're not in the risk business. And so because they're not in the risk business, them and mortgage insurance, insure because it's a regular house. Once you have an inspection and it shows that, hey, it smells, it acts, it looks like a house. If it quacks like a duck, it's a duck. And once you get people in, the I would call it the mystique of it being a shipping container goes away once you're inside, because you no longer feel like you're in a shipping container. You feel like you're either in a house, you're in a commercial, or you're in some form of residential. You don't feel like it's a shipping container. And I think as more people bill, the more the price will go down. But right now the price is high because it hasn't been, it's a proven concept, but it's not a accepted concept, if that makes any sense.
Is the shipping container material price more competitive now because of the wood scarcity in the marketplace?
Yes and no, depending where you're at in the country. Will determine, like I was just in Lowe's today, and I think I just saw 2x4s that back down to like $348, whereas probably a couple months ago, they were $1248. So depending where you're at, the prices is going down in some places and the prices is going up, and sometimes the prices are staying where they're at. So it just depends on where you're at. And then the other thing is being able to find a 2x4 that's straight. Because I don't know what it is with Lowe's, but every 2x4 has got a bend, and it's like, okay, if you would stop stacking them so high, you wouldn't get the bend. And so to be able to find straight 2x4s is a real challenge. Anybody in the housing market knows what I'm talking about.
When you purchase a container, can you not find out what was shipped in them?
No, you can find out what shipped on it. Once again, if you have those numbers, whoever you're buying your shipping container from, the broker or the doc can tell you exactly all the information on the shipping containers.
How high can they be stacked?
Anywhere between 6 to 8. And what's cool about them is, and this is where they say that, you know, they're mobile. If you look at a shipping container, they have this like a bolt and a screw, and that's how they're bolted and screwed on the ships. And that's why you're able to see them stacked so high. And when one falls, you see them do like a bend, but they don't fully fall over. It's because those brackets are in it. And another thing that we created what's called the L bracket. So the L bracket, we take it, we bury it into the concrete, and then it's welded against the shipping container. And so that makes it a solid foundation. It's not going to move. So that's something that we've kind of created along the way as we've been experimenting.
Are shipping container homes treated the same as trailers with respect to severe weather like tornadoes and high winds?
Like with anything, you know, you got windows, you know, windows can break because they're not 100%. You know, doors can break if they're not 100%. But the shipping container itself, if it's bolted to the ground, it's not going anywhere. The most thing that you'll probably have is a broken window or broken door. But if you do a steel door, if you take one of the shipping container's doors off and make that a door, that door is not going anywhere. And you can take it, if you decide that you want to keep them on, you can take it and close it up. And what I've seen so far in a lot of storms, nothing has happened. They don't move. They don't go anywhere. You know, you can feel maybe the wind moving around, but for the most part, they're solid.
And I have two last questions here that came from chat. This one is, where have you done housing for those who are houseless?
So we have not had a chance to do projects yet. Ours have been onesie, I call them onesie twosies. And we've only done three houses, and they've been in North Carolina. And that was basically, it was people that I knew that already had land. Like one we did where the father and the wife wanted to give their daughter their house. And so they decided to go in the back. And so we took three 20 footers and we made them a house in the backyard, and they just absolutely love it. And that's like that was our first project. And so we're still trying to get there. We would love to do a shipping container project here in Hillsborough. You know, I live in Hillsborough, I love Hillsborough, and I would love to do one, especially dealing with the homeless population and dealing with 55 and over, dealing with newlyweds, and dealing with the homeless population. You know, those are areas that I would love to, because I'm seeing so many young people who would love to have a home, but getting into a home is just so expensive. And I think this would be a great alternative for those who are just entering the market, that if we can make them affordable, but still look nice, still be cool, and be able to have a resale value that allows them to get to that next level of purchasing a home. Hope that answers your question.
Great answer. All right, I have one more question. Before I get to that question, do you have a slide with your contact information in case anyone here wants to reach out to you?
And I do. Can
you display that? And the last question I have here is, who is the partner you work with in Portland or acquire your containers from?
Once again, my wonderful people, let me go back to there. A second. Hold on, I got to do the old people thing when you got to take your glasses off so you can see. PDX container, here we go, bottom right here, pdxcontainer.com. But I also have a broker that I deal with that I just kind of met on a chat. And we've been kind of like sealed to the hip ever since then, you know. And so anytime that things are coming on the market, he'll call me and I'll say, hey, I've got, you know, 9 containers. Are you interested? Hey, I got 3. Hey, I got 2. I got 1. And so that's kind of been our relationship. And what's kind of cool about him being a broker, not only is he a broker, but he's also a driver. So that makes it easy. So I don't have to pay for an additional price of getting to move to different places. And the cool thing about it is that they do them throughout the United States, but we're trying to find a partnership with someone that if we can do them here, and then we can take them, put them on the back of a truck and send them out. So that's what we're trying to work on right now, that and raising capital in order to pull off a lot of these projects.
Okay, I think that's the last question I have. Does anyone else have a live question or no? And can you put your contact details back up so they can have that?
Sure.
And someone is asking, what's your email address? Which email address would you like out there?
Use my personal one because I get too many emails. So it's M as in Mary, J as in John, M as in Mike, M as in Matthew at 45@gmail.com. So that's MJMM45@gmail.com. I'll put it in the chat.
Yeah, I already got it for you.
Thank you, sir.
If we don't have any other questions, first, I'd like to thank you, MinNefer, for giving this presentation. I think it was very informative, and I think really gave, you know, shown some light on a topic that I know nothing about. I didn't know anything about shipping containers being used as homes. And then I would have had all of those other questions. I look at like, oh no, man, won't that rust in the rain? You know, all of those. And as soon as you say chemicals, I was like, yeah, no, I'm out, you know, you know, but I understand there's a process to getting them cleaned out and making them presentable and making them look cool. And like you, yeah, I'm a nerd and I need that tech stuff as well.
One of the things I forgot to mention, first of all, I humbly thank you for allowing me to do this presentation. I didn't think anyone would show up. So for all to show up, give yourself a round of applause. I thank you. One of the first things that we do when we get all shipping containers is that we power wash them. That's the first thing that we do. We power wash them to death. You know, sometimes we power wash them so much that the paint comes off, which is great. You know, because that lets us know that stuff that needs to go, and then we let them dry, you know, and then we make them a hot box purposely. So if there's any living organism, it's gonna die because of just the sheer heat. And then we go to work and doing what we need to do. So I'm happy to talk. You know, my wife challenged me to not be so passionate and so excited where I can talk your head off. So I hope I haven't talked anyone's head off, but this is something that's near and dear to my heart. This is something that, you know, not only for us to be able to make money, but able to give back to a community, you know, and to give back to different kinds of communities, you know. So that's the thing that we're trying to work on is how do we make this cool and hip?
So thank you again, MinNefer. And everyone here, just be aware that we will have another special presentation next month, October 26th. We should have a series of three in a row that are dealing with real estate. The next one will once again be presented by MinNefer, and it's about real estate investing. He also has a company where he buys duplexes throughout the Midwest. So he can speak to that topic of what do you do? What are some of the pitfalls? How do you get involved with it and all of that as well? And hopefully our third one early November will be about commercial real estate for businesses. So we're trying to present things that are beneficial for the community that are wealth building as well, at least these three, and some of the others down the road, maybe a little bit more informational as well. But I hope everyone could take some actionable, could take some information that MinNefer gave you today and put it to action. If this is something you're passionate about or interested in or curious about, how do I get involved in this field here? So yeah, I think that's it.
And to Tony, all I want to say, if anybody's interested, you're not competing against me because your style is your style. My style is my style. My thing is you can only be successful unless you give back to others. So I'm here to help anyone who's interested in this field. Feel free to reach out. I'll talk your head off. I've got, you know, too much, as my wife says, I got more useless information than that must be allowed to others. So don't think that you're competing. You know, you want to sit, you want to brainstorm. You know, you want to work together. I'm all for it. Feel free to reach out.
MinNefer, thank you. So MJ, thanks so much on behalf of the council. Thanks so much for this today. We'll see you next month. This was great. And I'm sure we'll probably have more people next month because we've going to be talking this one up because it was awesome. I was geeking out the whole time. And the whole time I'm thinking about one of my agencies down in Southern Oregon who they have a tiny home village. Mm-hmm. So, you know, keep thinking about the homeless housing and different communities, even around the country that we can connect with and see how we can make something like that happen.
I'm all ears. Feel free to reach out.
And for everyone that did show up, I know we lost a few that had to take off. There is a link for a survey that we'd like for you all to take and fill out. It will be emailed to everyone that came here as well. But more importantly, even if you don't want to do the entire survey, which should only take you 2 to 3 minutes, at least get back to us and with what are three concepts that you would like to see presented, whether it's related to your business, your industry, or something that you just want more information about that can help you, your business, gain wealth, gain knowledge, information, anything like that. We need more topics, but then also consider, can you present on a specific topic that's useful to the overall business community? That would be helpful as well. So keep that in mind. And I think on that note, Nancy, I don't think we have anything else. I think we can close the meeting.
Thank you, everyone. Have a good night.
Thank you.
Great job, MinNefer.
Thank you, sir.